Is it? Nope, okay. So I think we have everybody, Jeremy. Can you guys, you guys will know these. They're from Pew Packers.
Come on, Christopher.
A little louder, Jeremy. Here we go. Ready?
For this is right. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right.
Let me turn up a little bit more. Both of these we sing off. We sing these every Sunday.
You know these, Toby.
Here we go. Take that turn a little more. A little bit, a little more.
Strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Finally being strong. Lord and in the strength of his might. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally be strong in the Lord. Okay, we got one more time. I'm dying. Finally be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Finally be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally be strong in the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Psalms 107:1.
Good job, kid. Thank you. You guys will stand and sing with us.
Thank you.
last night here at the church, we had parents' night out. Well, parents weren't here, they were out. But we had a bunch of kids here having a great time and some great volunteers that put it together. So I don't want to list names because I'll forget people, but for those of you who did put it together and worked really hard, it was fun, it was awesome, the kids had a great time, and I bet the parents did too while they were away for a few hours, so thank you.
Your miracle working promise,
Of worship. I'm so thankful that this room is full of people that are seeking you, seeking your compassion, your grace, your love, and the salvation that comes through the blood of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that our hearts and minds are open this morning to hear the words that you've given Sean to speak, that they will enter us and prod us to do the work that you've called us to do, that we won't be reluctant, we won't be shy, that we will show the compassion that you've shown us to the people we come in contact with, and tell them the great news. That their eternity is sealed by the blood of Jesus Christ. All they have to do is accept him and follow his lead, follow the scriptures, and accept the incredible gift that you gave. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see some faces that I haven't seen in quite some time this morning. Some new faces, some not so new faces, and we love to see those as well. Wherever you are or however you got here, we thank you for being along with us. If this is your first time with us, thank you for being here with us. If you wouldn't mind, there's a little connection card that's there in the seat back in front of you. If you'd fill that out, it just lets us know who you are. Let us get to know you. Hopefully you'll stick around for a few weeks, get to know us, and see how we can just chase after Jesus together. Kiddos, I'm going to need your help to start out this morning. I thought you might be able to help me identify a couple pictures, okay? So I'm going to throw a couple pictures up. You just tell me what they are. Adults, give them a chance to answer before you, and then you'll have your chance, okay? So this is the first one. Anybody know who those guys are? The Power Rangers. Very good. How about the next one? If you can read, you got that one, right? Powerade, right? What's the next one? A Jeep, a car. There's a brand that goes with this that you'll have to know. Thought I heard it. Power Wheels? Okay, so that's Power Wheels, right? Power Wheels. If you're old enough, you remember that commercial, right? I'm just looking at Kyle for this one because I know he knows exactly. How about those ladies? Do you know who those guys are? The Powerpuff Girls. Okay, one more. What are those? Our power lines. Very good. Bo had it back there. What do these things all have in common? Power, right? Yeah. This morning we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk about the power that the Holy Spirit brings. And so listen for the word power as you guys follow along in your sermon notes for kids, right? And you fill out those things. You'll listen for the word power. And you're going to need to get ready right away. So if you got a crayon or a pencil, get ready. You ready? You got to count all these. All right. I'm not sure if you realize how much the word power is in the English language. We have cars that run on horsepower, right? If you need more people, you need manpower. Heard it back there. If you have superior fighting force, they say you have better firepower. I heard somebody say. If you have that firepower that's aerial, then it's air power, right? Yeah. We have brain power, willpower, superpower, underpowered, powering up, powering down, power surges, power outages, power strips, power tools, powerful, powerless, right? Power lifting, power boating, power plants, and sometimes we see a power broker who's on a power play to play off a power trip, right? You can have all of those things. There's a whole lot of power going on. Power seems to be very important to the English language. As I said when we began this series, it's about the Holy Spirit. And we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit's power this morning. Anyone remember the question that we asked last week? Some of you guys weren't here last week. But for those who were, what was the question that we asked last week? We asked the question, are you thirsty, right? Are you thirsty? I guess he threw it up there before you got the chance to answer. Way to go, Jeremy. Are you thirsty? We were talking about are you desiring closer fellowship or relationship with God through the power of the Holy Spirit, right? We were talking about being filled up with the Holy Spirit. Are you thirsty was the question we asked last week. And this is a question about the who of who the Holy Spirit is. If you're a note taker or someone who just wants to put something to memory, this is going to be the one statement that I would love for you to internalize from this sermon. And that is, the Holy Spirit is God's empowering presence. The Holy Spirit is God's empowering presence. And we're going to kind of break apart three of those words, God's empowering and presence, right? And so the first one is God, right? That the Holy Spirit is God. He is the person of God. He is God's person, he is God's power, and he is God's presence. Okay, and so before we even get to that, you have to recognize that I'm using a certain pronoun here. He, right? Not it. The Holy Spirit is a he and not an it. Many times when we talk about the Holy Spirit in our cultural context, we talk about it like it's the Force from Star Wars, right? It's something we tap into. It's something that we manifest in our lives. But that's not the way that the Scriptures talk about the Holy Spirit. He's always given this personal pronoun of he. He is the Holy Spirit, that he is a person, this idea that he is an active, not as an active force, but he's an active person who is alive and in the lives of each and every one of us who are a follower of Jesus. He's the third person in the Godhead, which is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, right? This is just Trinitarian theology. This is what is deduced from reading Scriptures and understanding who God is as he has revealed himself in his nature to be, that these are separate and distinct persons of the Holy of God, and yet they are all completely and totally God together. Additionally, Scripture speaks of the Holy Spirit specifically being sinned against, being lied to, being grieved. Right? You can't sin against, you can't lie to, and you can't grieve a force. Right? That's a person. That we're doing those things against. That's the way the New Testament talks about the Holy Spirit over and over and over. It especially outlines his role in comforting and in counseling and in convicting the believer. That he plays this role in our lives. That when Jesus talks about him, he says that he is the paraclete, the parakaleo, that he walks beside us, that we are called to be in fellowship with him. And he's sometimes called the advocate or the helper as well, right? This picture of this person who is there in the life of a Christian who walks with us in everything that we do, and we're supposed to be looking for ways to walk in step with the Spirit. And so that's the person of the Holy Spirit that we're talking about. Today I want to focus on the power of the Holy Spirit. Next week we're going to talk about the presence of the Holy Spirit and just the way that we see this play out in the lives of those who are believers. Before we dive into the Word, before we study what the Word says about this subject, let's go to its author in prayer. Father God, we thank you again for another opportunity, another day to come and to sit at your feet. Father, to gather around and listen to the Word as it's read. Father, listen as the Word is explained, Father, to ingest and meditate upon everything that you have given us in your Word to give us the nature and the truth of who you are and how you interact with humanity. Father, as we devote ourselves to the study of your Word, Lord, we want you to make it transformational in our lives. Father, that we would use these words and we would apply them so that we might be different than we were before they came to us. Father, it says that your Word goes out and it never comes back void, and we want it to be transformational in our lives as we apply it. So Lord, we just lift up these moments, we lift up the study of your Word to you, and most of all, we lift up the person of Christ who died in our place for our sins. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you have a Bible with you or a device with a Bible app, go ahead and open up to Luke chapter 1, right? New Testament. Luke, the third book in the New Testament. We're going to be right there. This is going to be a familiar passage. If you've ever been to a Christmas Eve service, you've probably heard this passage read or somewhere around Christmas. This is talked about, but this is a moment that Luke is recording the angel coming and talking to Mary about this baby that she's going to have. And so this is what we get in Luke chapter 1, starting in verse 30. It says, "But the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with the Lord. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him what?
Jesus.
Jesus, which means what? Anybody know what Jesus means?
Savior.
Savior, God saves, right? Yeah, that's what that name means. Next slide, Jeremy. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." And this angel calling him the son of David, calling David his father, is supposed to identify him to the people who are listening to this as the Messiah. It's supposed to give them this picture of who he is supposed to be. He is going to be the one who is going to come, and he's going to sit on this throne of David forever. And also, he's saying that he's not just David's son, but he is the son of the Most High. Right, he's the son of God himself. And so Mary is going to ask a very practical question right here. This is a very important question as well. She says, "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." And so the angel here is linking the Holy Spirit to the power that she's going to have come upon her. And what's going to happen in that is that she's going to give birth to a son where she has not been with a man. And so the power of the Holy Spirit is going to come. He's going to overshadow or envelop her. And this is going to cause the baby to come about. This is one of numerous examples that we can go to throughout the New Testament where we see power and the Holy Spirit intertwined. That these two things come with each other. That where we find the power of God at work, the Holy Spirit is evident. And where the Holy Spirit is, there is always power. The Spirit brings power. And if we jump ahead just a couple of chapters from there to Luke chapter 3, if you flip over a couple of pages in your Bible, Luke 3 is giving us another explanation of what we read last week in Matthew 3, where we were seeing the baptism of Jesus. And this is in Luke 3, verse 21. It says, "When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him like in bodily form, like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, 'You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased.'" And so the Holy Spirit comes in power on Jesus. Just as he came in the birth of Jesus, now in the ministry of Jesus, he comes and he gives him this power. The next chapter, we see what that power produces in the life of Jesus. If you flip over to Luke chapter 4, starting in verse 1, it says, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. And so Jesus goes on from his baptism into this period of temptation in the desert. He succeeds where Adam failed, right? And so this temptation of the devil, he resists all three of these temptations. And in verse 14 we read, Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. And the news about him spread throughout the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues and everyone praised him. Interesting. We see here again the picture of the power of the Spirit and the Spirit's presence in his life are aligned with one another. And then immediately he starts to walk in the power of the Spirit. Continuing in verse 16, it says, he went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue. And as it was custom, he stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him, and rolling it, he found the place where it is written. We would know this as Isaiah chapter 61. He reads, and it says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me. Again, that is a messianic language that he's using there. That the anointing that he's talking about here is the anointing of the Messiah. The word Messiah means anointed one. The name Christ means, it's just a Greek version of the Jewish Messiah, right? Christ is not his last name, that's his title, Jesus the Christ. He is the anointed one. And so this is, again, the picture of that he is the promised king in the line of David. This is a picture of the fact that he is the one that is going to be not just anointed with oil like all of the kings of the past, but he's anointed with the Holy Spirit. And for what purpose? Jesus continues. He says, to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind and to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began saying to them, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. This is Jesus' way of identifying himself to the people who are there. He wants them to know that he is the Messiah, that the time has come for the inauguration of the kingdom of God, that he's going to bring everything that the Old Testament prophets had promised. And so he goes on from there, and we see these miraculous signs start to follow the person of Jesus. He's healing blind people and they can see. He's healing lame people and all of a sudden they start to walk, and he's bringing dead people back to life. And these miracles are pictures, are signs that what he is saying is true, that they can be trusted, that him announcing himself as the Messiah is the truth of what is happening. And in the same way we saw in the Old Testament that signs and wonders would accompany the proof that what was being said was valid and true. We see this all the way back in the story of Exodus. When Moses throws down a staff, right, and it turns into a serpent, but then he picks it up again, and it's a staff again, and he turns rivers into blood, and he turns has all of these frogs that come, right? These miraculous signs that are supposed to be giving validation that God said, "Let these people go." We see signs and wonders all throughout, and this is what we're supposed to take away from what Jesus is doing here, is that the truth of God's word is evident in the miracles that he's able to perform. When God the Son became Jesus in human flesh, and he put away his godhood, his godly things, and in the man of Jesus, right, he was not omnipresent anymore. He couldn't be everywhere all at once. He was in one place at one time. And as Jesus, he wasn't omnipotent, all-powerful, right? He needed to rest. He needed food. We see this throughout his life. Jesus wasn't omniscient. He didn't know everything. He said that there were some things that were above his pay grade as he was in human form, and that one of those was that his return, that only my Father in heaven, he says, knows the day and the time. That I don't have that. Jesus' miracles were powerful signs that God's anointing, though, was on Jesus, and that Jesus was going to return back to his Father, and he was going to return back to being God of everything. As the Messiah, as the Son of David, and the Son of the Most High, these were identifying those claims that he made, though, were true. And so when Jesus turns water into wine, he's revealing who he really is. When Jesus walks on water, he's revealing his identity. He's proving that it's true. When Jesus restores sight or cures leprosy or he raises the dead, he's showing that he has the power of God working in him through the Spirit that is on him. And as Paul writes to an early church that he hadn't visited yet in the city of Rome, and he writes this in Romans chapter 8, he says this. He says, "You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but you are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from dead will also give your life will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you." So Paul is giving us the picture here that the same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from death to life lives inside of the believer. Inside of the immersed believer, the Holy Spirit has taken up residence and indwells you. And that same Spirit can do the same things today. Can he still cure disease? Absolutely. Can he still cause the dead to rise? Absolutely. Can he still heal sickness? Absolutely. And better than that, he can cause eternally damned people to be reconciled with their Creator. That we can be one with our God again in the same relationship that we were built for. Flawed people like you and like me can be reconciled to our Creator. Now I want to pause for just a moment and celebrate just that. What Jesus did in giving himself in our place for our sins so that we might have full reconciliation with God. And so when I come back, I'm going to put a little bit of legs on the power and how we access the power of the Holy Spirit. But for now, I'm going to invite up Brad. He's going to take us around the Lord's table.
Good morning, church. We recently returned from a family reunion last week. That's why Tobias and us were not here last week. And we have t-shirts. Hey, go to family reunions, right? You get t-shirts. And I came for the t-shirt, right? So we do t-shirts. We always have to make sure that on our t-shirts we have some sort of core tenet of scripture that we use to anchor our family reunion to. And this year's Psalms 46:1, that the Lord is an ever-present, he's ever-present hope in times of trouble, right? And so it's something that has been on my mind this week. If you'll bear with me just a second, I'm going to violate one of the core tenets that I have when I give communion devotions, because this time is all about Jesus. But I just want to share with you how Jesus showed up in our lives this week. I think it's important to understand that people live real lives. And instead of just giving some story from some analogy from some story that you don't know who those people are, our lives were touched in a significant way this week by death. There's some dear friends of ours that we found out on Saturday while we were in Cincinnati at the creation, at the Ark, with our family, that some dear friends of ours were tragically taken in a car accident, husband and wife taken together. Followers of Jesus, lovers of Jesus, parents, grandparents, friends, co-workers, they were just a, when I read in the Gospels and Jesus says we are to be a city on a hill, I think of these two people, because they lived a life in such a way that you knew they loved Jesus. But they were taken quickly, and are now experiencing peace at the foot of the cross of Jesus. And and we return home, and our son, our 27-year-old son, involved in an incident at 4 o'clock in the morning on the way to work, caught up in floodwaters. Phone rings, says, I'm in a ditch, I'm trying to get out of the car, and my heart's racing. I go from a dead sleep to scurrying around trying to find my son, lost in a flood. And I tell you, it's ever-present hope and help in times of trouble. And I thought about this verse that we wore on our backs as we walked around the Creation Museum. And I think about the sermon series that we're in the midst of, about the Holy Spirit. And when Paul tells us that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, we don't have to go to a building made by hands. He dwells inside of us. And when David wrote this psalm, looking forward through the mist of history to think about the promises that were given to him, about how there would always be a king on his throne. And when we come around this table, and Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he says, when we do this together, we are proclaiming the death of Jesus until he comes. And I think about how people without the hope of Jesus, who rely on self and who rely on dead religions who don't have a risen Savior as their king. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 11, or chapter 11, he says that we proclaim his death until he comes. So when we are here taking the bread and taking the fruit of the vine, we are proclaiming Jesus' death, but hidden in the text is the fact that he's coming back. He hasn't left us as orphans. When the apostles were on the day of Pentecost, they were at the ascension of Jesus, and the angels come and say, why are you standing here looking into the sky? That same Jesus has left. He's going to come back. And when Jesus ate the Passover with them, he promised them that if I go to prepare a place for you, surely I will come back and gather you up. That is the hope we have as we sit here around this table and we take these emblems, that we know Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. He's interceding on our behalf. And we, as the temple of the Holy Spirit, are gathered together proclaiming the beauty of the salvation that we have in a risen Savior. So I don't know what's on your heart as you come around the table today. I don't know. But I can tell you there is a Lord and a Savior who knows. And he greatly desires to be what the psalmist wrote in Psalms 46:1. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, do not fear. Though the earth gives way and the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and the foam through its mountains and they tremble at its swelling. And what he writes in verse 10 and 11, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. We have nothing to fear because of the death of Jesus and the fact that he conquered sin, death, and the grave. And that is what we remember when we come together around this table as believers, followers, and spirit-filled men and women of God. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning that you are our ever-present help in times of trouble. I praise you this morning, Lord, because of Jesus and the salvation that we find in his name alone. I thank you that he is at your right hand interceding on each of our behalf this morning as we come around your table, carrying the burdens of a week that has just passed. Some hearts filled with joy this morning come to the table, some filled with despair, some with burdens that are too heavy to carry. Lord, I thank you for the Holy Spirit that indwells each here that has surrendered their lives to the Lordship of Jesus, has been immersed and has received the gift. Lord, I just pray that we would come around this table united in the name of Jesus, laying our burdens down and allowing the Holy Spirit to work in our lives the way you have planned it and so graciously given him to us. We love you and we honor you in the name of Jesus this morning. Amen.
Brad, I want to thank you for that reminder. So many times we hear things like that. God's our place of refuge in times of trouble. We forget that times of trouble means there's going to be trouble that comes. It's going to be times of hardship, times of death, and sometimes water devastation. And I think that's an excellent reminder that it's not always sunshine and puppies for us. I want to finish this morning with three ways that we can pursue being filled with the Holy Spirit. These are certainly not the only ways that we can be filled with the Spirit, and the things that I'm going to say to you aren't an exhaustive look at any one of these three. So just know there's a whole lot more that goes into it than these, but I believe these are three things that will help us if we are interested in being filled with the Holy Spirit. The first is that we would pursue the Spirit's power in intimacy or in relationship, right? This kind of goes back to one of the things that we were talking about as we were talking about the Holy Spirit as a person and not as a force, right? If the Holy Spirit is a person, then it's a person we have relationship with. This is incredibly important as we think about the power of the Holy Spirit, because that power is in the person that we are in relationship with. We see this, I think, a very good picture of the error that can come along with this in Acts chapter 8. a great illustration of the way that this plays out in one situation. Philip is in a town in Samaria. He's engaged in ministry. There are huge crowds of people who have come to him. They're attracted by the things that he is able to do. These people are believing, and they're being baptized, and they are people with demons that are being delivered. There are people who are paralyzed, who are being able to walk, and all of a sudden there is this man there named Simon. And Luke, as he's writing this, he calls him Simon the Sorcerer, because he's known for his sorcery. He's known for the fact that he can do these odd things that people are enamored by, and he kind of draws attention to himself, and he sees what Philip is doing. He sees the miracles that Philip is able to perform, and then John and Peter come to the town just a little bit later, and they lay hands on the believers there, and they're given the Holy Spirit, and Simon, he sees this, and he wants that power. He says, man, that's something that I could use to my benefit. And so he goes to Peter and he says this in verse 19. He says, give me also this ability so that everyone whom I lay hands on may receive the Holy Spirit. And so Peter answers him and he says, may your money perish along with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with the Spirit. You have no part or share in this ministry, because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord in the hope that he may forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. And so Peter sees this request that this man has made, and he sees that the source of this request is not an honesty toward God, but rather it's a seeking of bringing recognition to himself, and he rebukes Simon, and I would say pretty harshly here. He says, hey, may your money perish with you. You have no part in what we're doing. You have no part in this ministry. And I think that so often, many of us in the American church, we fall for the same error. It's the error that I mentioned a moment ago, that we want the gift and we don't want the giver. We want the provision, we don't want the provider. Right, we want the benefits, and we forget that there's a person attached to that benefit. I was thinking about this week, and I don't know how many of you guys have ever seen the amazing feats of strength of one Link Burchett. He posts these on Facebook, these amazing feats of strength, right? And Link back here, he's shaking his head no at me, but I've seen them. He lifts houses like deadlifting, and he benches Volkswagens. He's an amazingly strong guy, just a dude with no fashion sense whatsoever, in the garage in his house, just lifting everything. Giant bars filled with weights, you know, showing off all of his strength. Now, if I want to move something in my home, right, I don't stand in my living room and summon the strength of Link Burchett, right? That's not going to help me. I would probably just give him a call and say, hey, Link, would you help me move something? Right? Because that would be much more wise of me, because I know the person, right? And I have some sort of relationship, although this might hurt that. I have some sort of relationship with him that I think he would come and help me move things, because there's a level of relationship there that gives me access to his power. Right? In the same way, we have access to the power of the Holy Spirit because of the relationship we have with the person of the Holy Spirit. He is a person that we are in relationship with. And so as we grow in relationship, as we grow in intimacy with the Holy Spirit, we will have more access to the power that he brings, more power through the strength and the help and the comfort and the encouragement, all of the things that the Holy Spirit offers to us in this relationship that we have with him. This is why I think Paul writes to the church in Galatia, in Galatians 5:25, he says this, he says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. See, that's God's desire for our lives, that we would stay in step with the Spirit, that we would walk side by side with the Spirit through life, that we would have this relationship with the person of the Holy Spirit, that we would be at his pace and working in his purpose, that we would walk right along with him through life. And so, first, we pursue the Spirit's power through intimacy. Second, we need to pursue the Spirit's power in holiness. And I know that word gets a lot of negative baggage, but let me just explain to you what I mean by it. For most of the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit is just called the Spirit of the Lord, or the Spirit of God, right? We see this all throughout the Old Testament. It's not until the New Testament that he gets this name, the Holy Spirit. And it starts with Jesus. Jesus is the first one who kind of calls him the Holy Spirit. That this Holy Spirit is going to come, and this Holy Spirit is going to live in believers. This Holy Spirit is going to be this gift of God living in us. And this is the name that Jesus primarily gives for him. So holiness must be part of what the Holy Spirit is about, right? There must be something in that name. Holy just means set apart, right? Most of you know that, have heard that sometime. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit sets us apart from, and he sets us apart for, right? He sets us apart from those things that would be opposed to God or the things that God opposes. And he sets us apart for the purpose of God and what God wants in our lives. And so many times in the New Testament, we will refer to the things that we're supposed to be set apart from as the world, right? Or just the societal, the cultural pitfalls that are all around us. This is what the scripture talks about as the world. Those things that are our habits that we fall so easily right back into, or those things that are external from us but draw us to them, knowing that they oppose God or that God opposes them. And so it means saying no to the way of anger and violence. It means saying no to the way of materialism, the way of greed. It means saying no to lust and promiscuity and objectifying other human beings. It means saying no to gossip and slander. And that's what it means to be a part of what it means to be holy, to be set apart from those things. It also means that we need to be set apart for something, right? And so the part that we're set apart for, though, isn't just something, it's someone, right? We're set apart for God, the Spirit. Holiness means we are dedicated to the Lord. And so as we dedicate ourselves to the Lord, guess what? Our lives look different. How you think about work and money and parenting and marriage and relationships and community and everything changes because of our relationship with God, our devotion to him first and foremost. There's this symbiotic relationship between the holiness of our lives and the power of the Holy Spirit working in those lives. This means that every temptation to disobey God, right, every temptation to go our own way and sin, is an opportunity also to obey, to stay in step with the Spirit, to follow after what God has for us. We see this perfectly in the example of Jesus in the temptations, right? He's there and these temptations are before him. It's this opportunity he has to either walk in his own way or to walk in holiness, to walk with the Spirit. And temptation one, temptation two, temptation three, he emerges, it says, full of the power of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is with him, and he draws near to the Spirit as he overcomes these temptations. Every temptation we face in our lives is a moment for us to grow in the power of the Holy Spirit. That if we would cling to him in intimate holiness, we will see that his power is there to lead us through those temptations. We pursue the power of the Holy Spirit in intimacy and holiness. And finally, we pursue the Spirit's power in faith. As you read through, and I kind of picked this up this week for the first time, as you read through the New Testament, 26 of the 29 miracles of Jesus have faith attached to them in some way. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? Like, if you look through all of the miracles of Jesus, there's some mention to faith in 26 of the 29 miracles. That he performed these miracles because of the faith that he was amazed in other people. Or he performed these miracles and their faith was increased. Or he performed these things and said their faith had healed them. Or he says he didn't do miracles in one place because they didn't have any faith. We see faith attached to 26 out of 29 of Jesus' miracles. And we can certainly see the attachment of faith and the Spirit's power in that. Faith means believing that God genuinely is eager to deliver his goodness. It is this picture of our confidence in who God is, that he eagerly is wanting to give us his goodness. And so we trust in that. We trust in knowing who God is and what his character is like. And this again is what God is trying to do in our lives, to build our faith, to have us increase in faith in Him, to have more confidence day by day in who He is, how He has came through in our lives, and how He will continue to in the future. And so we increase our intimacy, we refine our holiness, we build our faith, and as we do this, we grow in relationship with God, the Spirit. If we are living lives that are detached from that relationship with God, if we are living in disobedience, or if we are going away from the standards and the guardrails that God has placed around us, if we are living in complete reliance on our own strength, our own resources, our own abilities, how would we ever experience the power of the Holy Spirit? How would we even recognize it if we did? Because we think that everything is on us to fulfill. How much do you and I want to experience that power of the Holy Spirit in our lives? And if so, are we willing to pursue Him in relationship and in holiness and in faith? Do we want to see God move in our lives? Do we want to see God move in our marriages and our relationships, our jobs, more? Do we want to experience God in deeper ways and transforming lives, transforming us day by day and moment by moment? If we do, then we just have to put down our phone, we have to put away distraction, and quiet all of the noise, and genuinely pursue Him in relationship and the way that He has called us to, and we will grow in His awesome power. And Father, that's what we come to you this morning asking for more of. Father, we are thirsty for you. Father, we are in deep, desperate need of your Spirit and the power that He brings in our lives to overcome temptation. Father, to overcome the pitfalls of the world that we see around us. Father, to pursue Him in relationship and holiness. And Father, to pursue Him in faith that you are the person that you have said that you are. And as we grow in relationship with you, Father, we are thirsty to feel the power of the Holy Spirit filling us up from within, that we can walk in step with the Spirit. Father, that we can be Jesus to the people in our lives. And Father, introduce Him to the one who has saved our souls. Lord, as we come to you this morning, just lifting these prayers to you, Father, we know that you are faithful to your word. We know that you are willing and able and wanting to pour out your Spirit on each and every one of us. Father, each and every believer in this room has the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so we just ask that you would help us tap into it through relationship with you. Father, I pray for every believer in every person in this room who is not yet a believer. Father, for anyone who is here this morning and they have not accepted the gift of Jesus' sacrifice in their place for their sin, they have not been given the gift of the Holy Spirit to live within them, I pray that this would be the day of salvation for each and every one of us as we come to this time around reflecting and responding to the Word of God. Father, whatever it is that we have going on in our lives, Father, would you just move us in your Spirit to respond today? Lord, we love you and thank you so much that you came to this earth. Father, that you put away the powers that you had and for all of eternity so that the person of Jesus would die in our place. Father, give us the gift of His righteousness in raising victorious over sin, death, and the devil. And Father, giving us the promise that for each of us who believe in Him, who are covered in the waters of baptism and raised to newness of life, are given the gift of the Holy Spirit. Father, that's what we come celebrating today. That's what we come yearning to walk in our lives. Father, that's what the gift that you are offering to each and every person in this room who hasn't experienced that yet. Father, just pray that your Spirit would work mightily in us this morning. And in the name of Jesus, we bring these prayers to your feet. Amen. Would you stand with me? We're going to have a song of reflection and response. So this is just, again, a moment for us to respond to what you've heard today. And maybe in response to something that you heard, you want to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You want to know that Jesus died in your place for your sins. And if that's where you are this morning, I'm going to be up here in the front. I would love to talk to you about the next step in that walk for you. Come and talk with me. Come and visit and just let me know where you are and how I might come alongside of you and how I might see you follow after Jesus. Maybe you're here today and you have some struggles in your life, like Brad talked about. You have some things that are just weighing heavily on you, and you need someone to pray along with you. Man, there's a room full of people here who would love to lift those things up to Jesus along with you. If you're here today and you need prayer, grab one of us and just say, hey, would you pray with me? This is what I'm going through. This is what I'm dealing with. And would you be there with me through it? Whatever it is that the Holy Spirit is laying on your heart today to respond to, though, as we reflect during this song, respond. This could be the day that everything changes for whatever that is for you. Let's sing.
Yeah.
you guys want to take a seat, Terry's going to bring some announcements. Sean's going to bring some.